Journey with Judy.
Honest, open, transparent. It's hot.
There's no such thing as perfect people. There's no such thing as a perfect life. So come as you are, broken and scarred. Lift up your heart and be amazed and be changed by a perfect God.
Good morning. Thank you for choosing to journey with Judy this morning. And the Hairs live through Christmas again in 2012. And I'm here to tell you that we are no happier now after Christmas than we were before Christmas. And here's what happened before Christmas. 2 days before Christmas, we were watching TV, 7:30 at night, and all of a sudden, bam, lights went out. Everything was black as far as we could see. And just for like a brief second, I had to do a woodshed conversation with Bobby because I thought there was maybe some credence that I needed to give to the fact that the world was coming to an end, maybe 2 days later than what the Mayan calendar anticipated. And as it turned out, a transformer blew, and there we were in the dark, which is where I've spent most of my life. And as we know that people who walk in darkness just simply adjust their eyes. And for just a little bit, we thought we were the only ones who were living in this state of darkness, because really, as we looked across the lake, there were lights on. And, as you know, it was just like in our immediate surroundings that seemed like so dismal and so dark. And as we stumbled around to try to figure out, you know, what we were supposed to do next, we kept trying to turn on lights and do things that became obviously very apparent how many things we take for granted. But to make a long story short, we gathered our stuff, went to somebody's house, and 48 hours later, Dave, 2 days before Christmas or something like that, 36 hours later, I don't know, we had no power. We could not go into our house. I think the temperature was like 55 degrees in our house. Yeah. So anyway, but here's the really sad part is that we were exactly the same people before the darkness as we were after the darkness. And the main theme in the Hare family was simply like, can I do this? And when can I do that? And why can't I do that? And we just were totally self-absorbed as we were when we were living in the dark. So the Hares became the darkness. And even though I felt like we were the only ones without power and the only ones living in the dark, we realized that we weren't. And there was hope in that, Dave. Like, I was happy to know that 7,000 other people were living in the darkness for just this small period of time, which seemed monumental 2 days before Christmas, because that was the only most important thing, was the things that we needed to get done that had to be put on hold. But here's the deal. We just adjusted to a new normal. This time last year, we made some commitments. We resolved to keep them. And shortly into 2012, we just adjusted to a new normal. See, it's that time of year again where we're making resolutions. I hope you are. I'll tell you the statistics of who does and who doesn't and how they last in just a little bit. But the fact of the matter is, nothing changes when nothing changes. The Hare family this time last year sat down with a lot of bickering and complaining, of course, and we said, Bob agreed that he would do this with me, and I love my man because he is always so supportive of the dumb ideas that I come up with, believing that it'll make a difference if we just commit together to follow through. And we said to everybody, what can you bring to our family? What is the one thing that you would agree to bring that would make a difference? And here were the things, in order, oldest to youngest: patience, prayer, mercy, respect, acceptance, and peace. And we all agreed that our whole family would be different if we just agreed to committing publicly to this one thing. And the thing about making a resolution is it has to be specific, it has to be realistic, and it has to be made known. And those are the three things that we did. I even took the time to have every person in our family write down the one thing. Write it down, to own it. And then I pasted it right there where anybody who walked in the house could see it, where it would be a constant reminder to us every day of just the one thing that we committed to doing. I'm here to tell you, as we approach 2013, those signs are still hanging there. And it's only 2 days before the new year. But we've actually even changed them from their original intent. I'll tell you about that when we get back. You're listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. We'll be back. Okay, so I'm taking Mandisa's advice and I'm leaving it behind me and I'm starting a new day and knowing that it's a good morning because God's mercies are new every day. And even though the hairs dramatically fell down on the job in 2012 and we made these decisions that required determination and resolve, we made decisions to do and to not do one thing. And 1 year later, I had to change those signs. Because if we're going to be hot, which is honest, open, and transparent, we got to tell it like it really is. We are part of the 97% who didn't follow through on their New Year's resolutions. And we even had to change our signs and our commitments. Here's how they read. Instead of patience, we put before it lack of. Instead of prayer, we added prayerlessness. Carter's sign about being merciful, we said no mercy. Chan went from respect to disrespect. So much for Kennedy and her acceptance, we added non before it. And there was Campbell, who was going to bring peace to our family, and we crossed it out and said disrupts the peace. But just yesterday when I looked at it, Campbell crossed it out again and said makes peace. So in Campbell's mind, I guess, she did what she was supposed to. But the fact of the matter is nothing changes when nothing changes. So as we approach this new year and we make these new resolutions, we just have to realize that at least if we're part of the 45% who makes them, that's good news. But the reality is 75% of us give up after 1 week. 38% give up after 1 month. And 97% of the things that we resolve to do, that we commit to do, never get fulfilled. So if we're specific, we're realistic, and we make our things known, why do we fail? See, because this thing about making a resolution, it's just a commitment that we make to one or more personal goals to either reform a habit or make some kind of lifestyle change that we know without a shadow of a doubt that it will be beneficial, and even more important, that in so many cases, it's so desperately needed. See, the key element is that it must be set apart from other things that we know that we got to do. Because there's always things that we end up doing that stop us from doing what it is we really ought to be doing. And see, I find this interesting is that we find and get more satisfaction talking about our resolutions than actually doing them. I mean, we have such a resolve about making this list, checking it twice, making it specific, realistic, and even publicly known, because that I think that increases our percentage of succeeding by 10% if we make it publicly known. And see, here's the bottom line. It's not that the hairs couldn't do that one thing. It's that we wouldn't. It's not that the commitment was too big or too vague or unattainable. It just wasn't the most important thing on a daily basis. See, the most common resolutions are about beating an addiction, getting healthier, being a better spouse or parent. My sister-in-law told me on Christmas Day, she said, you know what, I resolve every year to be a better spouse, and by New Year's Day, I quit. I don't know if she'll be listening, so I won't even comment on that. See, making them isn't the issue. It's keeping them. It's just the one thing that's going to change everything. So why don't we do it? There's expressions like in one year, out the other. This is your to-do list for the first week of January. I read something as I was Googling New Year's resolutions, and there was a couple that I actually found comical. It said things like, well, you could definitely succeed if you made resolutions like spend more money or spend more time on the internet or more time procrastinating or decide just I'm going to get a lot of resentments, I'm going to gain a lot of weight, I'm going to stop working, stop exercising, and stop praying. You are sure to succeed if those are your things. But see, success is based on eliminating old habits and then creating new ones. See, this minor adjustment in reality becomes a major improvement. See, for some reason, we hold on to things that it's time to let go of. See, in many cases, we hold on to the thing that we don't think that we can live without, but the reality is we're not living because of it. See, I want a new me. I don't want a new year. One of the things I look at when I'm doing this show is a picture of my kids or my family, and it just happens to be the Christmas card from last year. And as I look at this picture right now, every one of us looks so different. There's been so many things that have changed on the outside in 2012. I could name 100 things that have happened to the hairs in 2012. But see, the reality is we're still struggling with the same things as we did when this year began. Because nothing changes when nothing changes. And I'm so grateful for the new year and the new start to be who it is that God calls me and us to be. See, I want to aim higher. I want to reach further. I want to dream bigger. And I want to believe stronger. But the fact is whether you call it a tribe or you call it a clan or you call it a family, we all need one to help us become who it is we're supposed to be. So I came up with another really dumb idea for 2013 of how we can become all we're supposed to be. We're going to have to rip up our little signs from last year. And thanks to Mandisa, we can put them behind us and start a new year with something new. And I have to tell you, when I mentioned it to Bob, what it was, he goes, I just want you to know that sounds like the stupidest thing I've ever heard. However, I will support it if you change the name, because right off the bat, it sounds super stupid and they're not going to buy into it. So I'll tell you what that is when we get back. You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. And thank you to the Cunis Country Auto Group for sponsoring Journey with Judy. We'll be back. So let my life be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made of. How you lived, how you died, love is sacrifice. So let my life be the proof of your love. Okay, so that's what we want to do as people of faith. We want to let our love be the proof of his love, right? And where is that most difficult to resonate? I don't know about you, but for me, it's in my own family. It's the confines of my own home that I feel I spend so much time perpetuating the darkness and feeling like we're the only family who just can't ever change from the inside out. See, here's the deal. People under the influence should have an influence. And we're supposed to be people who are under the influence of the Spirit of God working, living, moving, and having his being. That should make us more responsible as people of faith. That should make us people who represent him in everything. Because on the outside, it looks one way, but on the inside, it's totally different. I told you I come up with these dumb ideas. My family calls them dumb generally, but most times if I can get Bob to be on board, we can make a movement as a family and a commitment to do something. Okay, so we still want to be specific. We still need to be realistic. And most importantly, we have to be public and make known the very thing that we are resolving to do. So I made a list of some things that we need to sit down as a family and talk about. There are questions like, what are the strengths of each individual? When we're at our best, what does it look like? How about when we're at our worst? What are the three things we could do better? What would people say about us as a family? And what's the one emotion that is so desperately needed in our home? See, this little project that I've been working on is going to stop us from spending so much time reacting to the crisis that we make bigger than it needs to be because we're so busy doing what ought to be done that we don't do what ought to be done. See, we got to start doing what he wants and not necessarily what we want, because that's where we have failed in our six things that we brought to the table last year that we resolved to do. We spent so much time saying, but he didn't, and I would if she didn't, or she isn't, so why do I have to? See, it's got to be a joint project. And if you're a good communicator and you're willing to compromise and you're willing to collaborate, this new thing that the Hares are going to be doing could be implemented in your life just as well. Okay, Dave, you ready for what it is?
Yeah.
It's a family mission statement. Okay, does that sound totally dumb? Bob said that's the dumbest thing he ever heard. But any company, any organization, anything. Carter's applying in a million schools. He's looking first and foremost at their mission statement. What does a mission statement say? It preludes, is that the right word? I think it is. What your vision is. If you are a group of people and you're trying to make a difference, you've got to have a mission. You've got to have a vision. And you all have to agree with what it is. See, those six things that the Hares wouldn't bring, even though we said we would and we said we wanted to, we chose to not do it. We all know that's the weak link. The resolutions that we keep making almost never change. It's the same thing. We just try to approach it a different way. So we are going to do a mission statement that includes three things: our priorities, our principles, and our purpose. The three P's. See, our priority just has to be something regarded as more important than something else. That's all. Our principle is going to be the foundation for the system of belief that governs our behavior. And the purpose of our home is just the reason why something gets done. Is that so difficult? Because if I had to choose, I would say my priority. Okay, personally, I would say my greatest resolutions would be in my marriage, in my mothering, and in my ministry. And those three things can come right back into this whole mission statement that I could bring to my family about priorities, principles, and purpose. Because see, the Hare priority, if all it was to be people of prayer, because that's more important than anything else, I'm thinking things would be different. And if the one principle we lived by, which was the foundation for the belief that governs our behavior, I choose gratitude. And if the purpose of our home, and remember the purpose is the reason for which something is done, if the purpose was love, then I'm pretty sure that all the resolutions that we made physically, financially, emotionally, relationally, would all come to fruition. And we would be one of the 3% whose commitments got fulfilled. But see, it can only become a reality if we all agree to be the one thing. Under the influence. I'm guessing there's a lot of people in Wisconsin who would like to be that. Come on, we just got to be people under the influence, because then we will be people of influence. And if you've gathered nothing else from our resolution show, I hope you realize the hares are people who need your prayers. Thanks for listening to Journey with Judy. We'll be back to wrap it up after the break. You are listening to Lake 96.1. So just one step at a time in the new year. Live for him. And live for him when nobody else is. Consider the mission statement. As stupid as it is, consider looking at the priorities to value, the principles to live by, and the purpose of your life. Because if you don't, nothing will change. Because nothing changes when nothing changes. The best of Life Matters is next. This week, keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. Peace out.